My name is Brian Oloo. Today our guest is Brianna Cea. She's currently a freshman. She has interest in political science. Welcome to our show.
Thank you so much for inviting me, Brian. Really excited to be here.
Awesome. So to first get started, what made you choose Binghamton University?
That's a good question. I actually didn't know I was attending Binghamton University until 2 weeks before school started. But one of the reasons why I chose Binghamton University in such a short period of time was because I loved the campus, I loved the outdoors feel, mm-hmm. the nature preserve, as well as the wonderful programs they have to offer, and for a great value as well. So that's one of the main, like, most important reasons why I chose Binghamton University.
All right, so does Binghamton live up to all your expectations?
As of now, this is my second semester as a freshman, so I definitely think it has. Mm-hmm. I've really gotten involved with different clubs on campus, and the faculty here are extremely supportive and very friendly. I've made great connections with political science professors as well as other extracurricular advisors.
Oh, that's really good. Actually, we met at a libertarian meeting our first time. I'm also a member of the debate club, and I saw you had a debate last week.
Yes.
So could you tell me more about that? What was that about?
So I'm part of all three of the political groups on campus, so Democrats, Libertarians, Republicans, and I told myself freshman year I wanted to go out and kind of figure out who I am, especially in a political sense. And I was approached by the College Republicans to debate for education, and the topic was free college tuition. Mm-hmm. And after doing some research and following the recent presidential election, I realized that my views on college education were more conservative. Mm-hmm. So I decided to debate, you know, against free college tuition. And that debate was very fun. It was very intense and involved, but I really enjoyed it with my peers and Democrats, Republicans, as well.
Oh, that's very interesting. Yeah, college is very expensive, each of us being college students ourselves. Now, it's very interesting that you took a more conservative view, since many of our peers tend to like Bernie Sanders.
That's
you know,
true.
Many people, quote unquote, are feeling the burn.
Yeah.
So can you please elaborate on why you think college education should be free?
So definitely, I like to identify myself more socially liberal on topics, but for some reason, when it comes to education, I like to take more of an economic viewpoint of it. So when I was doing research on how much it would cost to have free college tuition for 4 years, state universities, the number was astronomical. It was insane how much it would be to pay for this. I mean, I was looking into how Bernie Sanders, for example, was proposing to pay for this with the Robin Hood tax, that's what they call it. And unfortunately, a lot of my peers do not really look into the effects of a Robin Hood tax or how they would pay for it. They just kind of go for the rhetoric of free college tuition for everyone without looking at the costs and the benefit, the cost-benefit analysis of it. So after doing that analysis, I just felt really strongly against the long-term effects of having free college, well, at least for 4 years, state universities. But I'm all for, you know, 2-year community college free programs, but just the way they're going to pay for it, as well as the effects on our economy, I was very against that stance.
Yeah, I also tend to think that community colleges are a great way
to segue
to a 4-year university.
If
I had to do it over again, they actually offered community college courses in junior and senior year of my school. And I think the focus should be really on, you know, early education, I think, as well.
Exactly.
To get people more engaged and to get more free credits.
Yeah, and I mean, like, honestly, I would love to have free 4 year state, you know, tuition. I'm a student myself as well, so a lot of people think it's funny that I was arguing against it with my libertarian peer. But like I said, again, the way that the Robin Hood tax would affect our stock market, for example, would be very negative overall. And when I was debating, I also brought up the point of other alternatives to state universities, like vocational trainings. I have a personal connection with that one because my mom went to beauty school. And she was successful after beauty school, and then she had me and my father. My father, he went to the military right after high school, and he would receive the education through the military, and now he's a sergeant with NYPD, and received training through the police department. So our society puts a huge emphasis on this one pathway towards success, when I believe there's a lot of other alternatives for families out there who may not be able to afford the 4-year state university lifestyle.
That's very interesting. I'll segue into your dad being a police officer.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. But speaking of alternatives, you know, when you look at Binghamton University, it's very diverse. And when you take a look at issues like globalization, meaning that we have a lot of Asian students straight from China, we have a lot of Indian students who come straight here. And I think Binghamton represents a microcosm of the world competition. And, you know, even when I'm looking around classes, there's not too many minorities represented. Out of 200 students, there could be 4 African Americans. And I know BSU has spoke up against it, but it's kind of a paradox because I think Binghamton itself is giving us the best resources. They're bringing the best and brightest here. So what do you think about that in the sense that because, you know, having a bachelor's degree 20, 30 years ago was a real privilege, but now these blue-collar jobs, these vocational options are really limited. So, you know, do you think it's harder now if your dad was a college student or your mom was a college student or just getting out of high school, I mean?
I definitely, you know, now in society, I would have to say that I do believe due to, you know, past cases of affirmative action and especially the leaps that universities are taking to increase the diversity of their student population, that at least for my mother and my father, it would be easier for them now to go to a four-year university, especially now with the expansion of Pell Grant programs and other scholarships and financial aid alternatives. Myself, I already have like a loan coming out of here. It's pretty small to the state university, but I definitely feel like the education system has taken a huge leap in providing these resources to mm-hmm. families that may not have had the option to go to school. Mm-hmm. Like my mother, she went to beauty school because my grandmother had a business, mm-hmm. had a beauty salon, and so that's why my mother went to beauty school to support her family. Okay. But I think if she was in, you know, society, you know, my age now, mm-hmm. It would be easier for her to attend, mm-hmm. you know, four-year university away from home at least to support her family.
Okay. Now, beyond just, you know, paying for college, once you have the privilege or the luck to go to a college, recently Binghamton University has been having a quote-unquote conversation about race. Mm-hmm. Recently, our president resigned because of certain issues. So, what is your opinion on the state of race itself? You know, your dad being an NYPD officer,
yeah.
he definitely has to face a lot of racial tensions.
That's a great question. That's something that my family and I talk about all the time. And unfortunately, I do have to say over the past few years that there has been this increase in tension between communities throughout the country, and especially along the racial lines. And I think it's unfortunate because the rhetoric that the media portrays now is very divisive against police and their families and versus the communities. And I'm not going to deny, there are, you know, not everyone in uniform is a great person. My dad even tells me that there are some people in uniform that aren't the greatest officers.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not fair to portray all police officers
mm-hmm.
as, you know, racist and don't care for the communities. My father, he's a minority. He's an Asian American cop. He worked in Chinatown, has other minority officers, and that they feel it's unfair that this media is putting this portrayal on them, and they are minorities themselves.
Mm-hmm.
I do think one of the biggest steps that we can take even on campus is to increase the community feel between the different communities on campus. One thing I do see in Binghamton University, it's a little, clicky, I could say, with
yeah.
different multicultural groups.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I'd like to see in the future and that I'd like to work for is to increase unity between all the multicultural groups
mm-hmm.
so we can all understand each other and our values.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that same lesson can be applied to police officers
mm-hmm.
and local communities and go back to that model of community policing and having everyone, you know, trust each other,
yeah.
which I think we are a long way to achieving, but if we can work together with the media as well,
yeah.
it can hopefully happen one day.
Oh, all right. That's very thoughtful. Now, beyond just race, us two being minority,
yeah.
one difference being you are a female, and I don't know if you catch the Oscars this week.
I saw clips of it. Leo DiCaprio is my favorite.
Yeah, yeah, the Leo one. President Biden was there, and he spoke out for, you know, It's On Us campaign that Binghamton University is really keen on. You know, as a university student and a female, what are your thoughts on, you know, Binghamton University steps and just in general of the It's On Us campaign?
One of my biggest role models in politics now is Senator Gillibrand, and
mm-hmm.
she's been a huge force in this fight against sexual assault on campuses and increasing awareness on it. And I don't even have like a personal little note on this when it comes to sexual harassment and whatnot. I actually did a campaign in high school, Operation Sisterhood, that we advocated for female soldiers that have faced sexual harassment or assault in the military.
Mm-hmm.
I never experienced anything like that myself, but I had, you know, some peers in the military culture that spoke to me, and I was very touched by
mm-hmm.
by the negligence of society, of what they went through. So on Binghamton University's campus, I haven't seen that much conversation about sexual harassment and awareness on it. And I'm sure there are groups out there that are working for this. I definitely think it would be useful if Binghamton University was to perhaps put more advertisement or more publication of these steps towards It's On Us campaign on campus, or these student groups that are working for it.
Yeah, interesting. So you mentioned Kristen Gillibrand. So you seem to be very politically engaged. Yesterday was Super Tuesday.
Yes.
So what is your opinion on the state of the union, on the presidential race?
That is a great question, because right now I am so confused with the state that we are in right now, because Super Tuesday, we have Donald Trump, who won 7 of the states yesterday. And it, I have to say, it scares me, because I feel, as a moderate Republican, even as a moderate Democrat, I would say too, that the way that the political, the presidential race is going, it's very divisive. We had two extremes campaigning on this campaign trail. You have Sanders and then you have Trump. And it felt like there was no in-between for those in the country who don't have as radical views as Donald Trump or as radical views as Bernie Sanders. Mm-hmm. And after watching Super Tuesday yesterday, I definitely feel like the way that the media has been portraying the two candidates, as well as the election, and just the rhetoric that's been going on social media, has really created this divisive environment in politics. Mm-hmm. And as a moderate, I feel abandoned, because I do not feel like Donald Trump at all represents the Republican Party that I once stood for. And Sanders, his movement was very successful among college students, but once again, it was very, very liberal to the left. And Clinton, she does provide that moderate to the Democrats. I personally am not the biggest fan of Clinton. I would love to see a female president in the White House one day. Just not sure if Clinton is my girl for that. But like I said, I'm very nervous to see where the country's going, with especially on the side of the right, with Donald Trump. And I do believe that it could eventually lead to a realignment of the Republican Party, at least, for sure.
Yeah, definitely the establishment. You know, I know House Speaker Paul Ryan. Spoke out, you know, against Trump, especially with the Muslim comment, and he just spoke out against Trump yesterday. It's interesting. I definitely tend to agree with your point. I tend to see the world in the sense that moderates, you know, usually the middle class, in our day-to-day lives, a lot of people are not political.
Yes.
You know, if you were to maybe ask a few people, do you watch politics, certain people are not really engaged. And in the sense of the two extremes, I feel like the people who really care, you know, when you really care about something, you're more inclined to go out there and vote. You're more inclined to go out there and protest. However, the majority of the United States is not in poverty. A majority of people tend to do well. And I believe this circumstances doesn't allow people to go out there and vote, you know, really to get the vote out there. I believe that, you know, America is definitely moderate, but I believe, as you said, that it's just the two extremes really control the debate. And I also think the fourth estate, being the media, has some culpability.
Exactly.
I think the sensationalization of, you know, Trump, he gets so much media coverage.
So much.
He doesn't even need to, you know, use his own money to campaign. So I think the Republican Party is shifting, but I don't like the way it's shifting.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It definitely, and I have to say that this election, 2016, is the year to show us, and it's testing our two-party system, I believe. We have this extremely divisive campaign, whether it's Donald Trump again, or Sanders, Clinton, and all the other Republican candidates. And I have to say, people ask me all the time, like, what are you, Brianna? Are you Republican? Because you have some conservative viewpoint. Well, not really conservative, but moderate viewpoints. Are you a Democrat because you're pro-choice and whatnot? And I like to tell people that I don't like to identify with the party personally. And that's why I like to really focus on local government, besides just the national elections. Because I feel like the main point of politics is for us to go out there and get our voice heard. And you know what? Not everyone needs to have opinions that are extremely aligned with one party. Myself, I could vote Democrat or Republican, essentially an independent. But I just don't think it's fair that we put such emphasis that if you believe in this, you are a Democrat, you are a Republican. And then they have the whole stereotypes now, the Democrats and Republicans. And it definitely is testing our two-party system and the whole portrayal of party identification in this country.
Yeah, personally, there was rumors that, you know, Michael Bloomberg was going to run.
Yeah.
I wish he would have run. I definitely like some of what he has done with New York. Definitely, he's definitely made New York a much more safer place. You know, of course, he has his own criticism. But the main point that you did say is local government.
Yes.
I know mayor of Chicago, Ron Emanuel, in the interview on Charlie Rose, which is my favorite show, by the way, he did say that Washington is broken.
Yes.
And, you know, even if you look at, you know, the House and you look at the executive branch, it's really hard to get stuff passed. And even a comprehensive bill like Obamacare, you know, it's going to take about 7 years for it to fully implement. And I do think local government is probably the best opportunity for change. What is your ideal community? What sort of steps would you like to take, or if you had the opportunity, you would take to make a better community?
Yeah, definitely. I think the local government, and a lot of college students don't realize this, but the local government is what affects you every single day.
Mm-hmm.
Even back at your hometown, not even just at Broome County.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the biggest things that I would like to see and that I'm working on currently is that more youth involvement in the local governments, having more youth go to the budget hearings, go to the legislative hearings in their hometown, talk to the councilmen and councilwomen, and really get their voice heard, because the legislation that is passed in your hometown, it's not as partisan as Washington is, for example. There's a lot of bipartisan work that occurs in local government. And one of the best things about local government is that when you are campaigning or voting for a candidate, you're voting for the candidate. You're voting for the policies and the platforms that they stand for. You're not just voting, you know, for them as a Democrat or as a Republican. So as a student now, I would like to see, especially in Broome County, more increased involvement, student involvement between students and local government officials as well.
Yeah.
And I'd like to see that in the upcoming election year, 2016.
Yeah, I know Broome County, I did a project where I had to interview local businesses. I know since IBM left, Broome County, which is in Binghamton, New York, it's really had some hard times. And in terms of, I know one of the complaints businesses have is you have people coming in from the city, you have a lot of crime. And just Binghamton in general as an area, it needs a lot of improving. Now, you're from the city, or where are you
from?
I'm
from Long Island, so I'm around Stony Brook, so
okay.
I'm right around Stony Brook University,
so
Suffolk County, Long Island.
Yeah, I think definitely locality is one of the best determining factor of social mobility.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, we do want to have an opportunity to move up the socioeconomic class. And one interesting fact I realized is that most of Binghamton students do come from Long Island.
Yes.
They come from New York City, and the international students who are able to come here tend to be pretty wealthy just because of the cost. And what's interesting is that you have this, you know, tale of two cities where you have sort of certain quote-unquote privileged people in Binghamton who then get an education here because it's a wonderful school, and then sort of just leave. And it really, I feel like Binghamton University is the lifeline of this county. So what are some of the ways, you know, or strategies that a city like New York or a place like Long Island could do to help maintain that energy once these bright students leave and go back home?
Great point about that is I spoke to other politicians in the area and worked with other officials because I am part of the Roosevelt Institute, which is a new club on campus, a collegiate policy think tank. So what we do is we basically go out, talk to government officials, do research on the local area, and then try to write policies that we can advocate for. And for what you were describing was exactly what we call the Binghamton brain drain. And if you look at the amount of job, like when it comes to unemployment rates throughout New York State, Broome County is always consistently ranked as one of the highest unemployment rates in New York State.
Yeah.
And I think one of the biggest things that Broome County can do, as well as other communities throughout New York for areas like the Southern Tier, is to promote innovation and to promote businesses to come here and to increase the amount of job opportunities. Because for a lot of students, you know, they're going to go back home because their jobs back at home. There are jobs in New York City. There are jobs in Long Island. And I feel like for a place like Broome County, we need to help increase innovation and entrepreneurship in this area. Deal with the urban infrastructure here, create a more a cultural center, and I have to say, City of Binghamton is taking the steps. They are taking the steps to do this, but I feel like if students were to get more involved, they would help these steps incrementally and really increase Binghamton's progress to maintaining students.
Yeah, I think one, I'm from Poughkeepsie, New York, which is about 90 minutes from the city. I am the last stop on Metro North.
Really?
Yeah, so I consider myself still Lower New York. But one of the things that does help Poughkeepsie is that is transportation. And I feel like people do like to travel. I feel like capital can come to Binghamton if there is innovation, if there is, quote unquote, a reason to come to Binghamton. Mm-hmm. You know, we go to local Midwestern states, you know, to see a tower or to see amenities. I think one of the things that Binghamton could improve on is, their infrastructure,
yeah,
and having you know, special services that otherwise could not happen. New York in general, I know in certain parts, the Detroit casinos, I know New York, they're against fracking. But one of the things that I believe could really help local establishments is, you know, maybe perhaps the legalization of marijuana. I don't know what your opinion on that is, but do you think more government regulations really kills businesses? Or what are some of the policies like legalization of marijuana, or perhaps less stringent business restrictions? Do you think those will help businesses?
I'm definitely all for less government intervention in businesses and promoting innovation. When it comes, but one interesting thing about medical marijuana, at least in this area, is that the Binghamton area was,
yeah,
approved to have one of the first medical marijuana dispensaries in the area. So that will be interesting to see the amount of revenue that's going to come in from the medical marijuana dispensary.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to be it's 20, 30 minutes away from here. And I've talked to some government officials about that as well, and they believe that the revenue that comes from the medical marijuana dispensary will help, you know, increase the budget,
mm-hmm,
or at least plug in some holes in the county legislature,
mm-hmm,
and which hopefully can increase programs,
mm-hmm,
whether it has to do with combating the heroin epidemic that,
mm-hmm,
we face in,
yes,
Broome County, or perhaps you know, promoting or fixing the urban infrastructure,
yeah,
anything that we discussed before.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to do say I'm all for maybe less government regulation,
mm-hmm,
in business. But I do agree with, in a sense, governments, who local governments that want to promote business through, like, perhaps providing grants,
right,
or some sort of subsidies.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not for those who want to restrict business or increase regulations.
Yeah, I definitely think one of the main key points is communication.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was just, you know, talking to local businesses, they said that they do want Binghamton University to be more more open. And even the heroin epidemic, I think it's hit the whole eastern part of the United,
mm-hmm,
States, Poughkeepsie, where I'm from. And I think, you know, heroin in of itself is a drug. And I think people who take it want to escape reality. And I think it's a deeper problem of mental health.
Definitely.
And again, I think one thing that Binghamton students were upset about is that they're reducing their mental health services. I don't know if you're aware. So they're trying to limit that, and since we're students, we pay for it. What are some of the, you know, things you think that we can improve on in mental health and really helping students who have problems so they can speak to somebody instead of turning to dangerous drugs like heroin?
Oh, definitely. And one of the unfortunate things in culture that we have nowadays is the stigmatism of those who are addicted to substances like heroin, alcohol. And it's very unfortunate because, like you said before, it is a mental illness.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned a lot about this topic last semester. I was never really aware of, you know, the dangers of heroin back, because at my hometown I wasn't affected by it. But I came here and I really got involved with learning about this issue facing the community, trying to help fix the portrayal of those who are affected by it, those who are addicted to the substance.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, I was looking to statistics that Binghamton University, our students, have not been as affected by this heroin epidemic as the local residents have,
mm-hmm,
been. But when it comes to decreasing mental health facilities, I think that that is the wrong step in that direction. I think, if anything, we should increase the amount of mental health resources and facilities for our students,
mm-hmm,
especially, you know, as a college.
Yeah.
I feel like as a college student, we're very stressful.
Yeah.
We're very stressed. We're very, we can be overwhelmed,
mm-hmm,
with, you know, the current lifestyle that we're in.
Yeah.
So I think instead of taking away those resources, we should definitely invest more and promote those type of services for our students as well.
Definitely. So before I let you go, you being a freshman and you having 3 more years left and working with local government, what is the top 2 or top 3 things you would like to see in the future, or that you've already started working on, that you think could really make Binghamton your next 3 years good?
Definitely the biggest thing I'd like to see is a friendlier, or a really friendly environment between the local government and students. And I would like to see students to go out beyond the bubble that we have on campus. And students at Binghamton are very active on campus when it comes to different issues, whether it's what happened recently with the multicultural groups or climate change or anything like that. our students are very active on campus, which is fantastic, but I would like to see more student involvement off campus and increase this activism in Broome County. And that perhaps could change the culture that we have here in this county, whether it is vote, you know, going out to vote at local elections, and also talking to our government officials to tell them what we care about as students, because we are constituents as well, whether it is for 4 years while we're here or potentially, you know, stay here in the future if they were to put that push towards having students stay more. So one of the biggest things that I like to see is more student involvement, political activism off campus, a friendly environment between local government officials and students. And I have to say I'm lucky enough to know one government official who has expressed this interest in change and breaking that barrier between local government and our students, besides, you know, the typical like internships, the typical stereotypical stuff like that, just to really get create that political activism culture in Broome County. So while I'm here as a student for the next 4 years, I'd like to see that, to see more events downtown, to see more student involvement in that sense.
All right. Well, thank you for being one of our guests. Thank you for joining us. And please come back again and have a conversation with us. Bye.